So we're starting the session now. So now we'll be having a hands-on session on ECG analysis, and we have with us Parvez Salman and Sivashish Sahu from IIT Guwahati. They are from EMST lab, and they are students of Professor Somane Dandapat sir, who have given us the morning lecture today, and they will be providing the insight into hands-on for ECG signals. So without any further delay, I'd like to welcome them and give them the platform. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon everyone. Thank you Jyoti sir. So before we begin today's session, I just want to know that everyone has downloaded this file and they are able to extract the files.
Sir, downloaded but not able to extract.
Okay. Any issues, particular error message you are getting? Like what is the error message you are getting?
Sir, it is the NPY file.
Oh, no, fine. If you are able to get NPY file, that's fine. So there will be three files.
Yes, sir, three NPY file.
Yes, fine. If you are getting those three files, it's fine for now.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I hope everyone was able to download and extract these three files. One is raw ECG file and one HC1, one MI1. Okay. So we will be doing this today's session on Python. So Python is a programming language. So before we begin, I just want to know how many of you are aware of Python, like have worked in Python, so that I get an idea how to pace up today's session. Just a gross idea if I get, then it's fine.
Because most likely many of them may not be knowing Python, so you may start from the basics.
Okay, sir. So it's okay if you have not worked in Python before. So our approach will be more about conceptual. So code part, okay, it's okay. It might take some time to get, but you can get the idea. If you have earlier worked with MATLAB, you can get the idea easily. Or any programming language you have earlier worked, it will be fine. So, okay, let me share the screen now. I hope my screen is visible.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Yes.
So we will be using Google Colab for today's session. So Google Colab. Go to Google and I would request everyone go to Google Colab and create an account if you haven't. If you have any Gmail account, it will be fine. You will be able to log in. Okay. And I'm sharing one file with you, collab file, in which I have already written the codes. So we will go through this file. So you can see in the chat, one collab file is given. You, after creating the account, you just try to open it.
Should we need to create an account in Colab or what should we do now?
Yes. In a Gmail account, you just have to log in to Colab.
Yeah, it's open and it is. I can able to see that code as well.
Okay. So this code you are able to see, right? The screen.
Yes.
Okay, fine. That's fine. I hope everyone is able to open this. If anyone has any issues, then they can comment, or else we can move forward. So this Google Colab is basically a Jupyter Notebook environment, so where we can run Python programs. So, and the best part is it is free, and also we don't have to install anything in our systems. Plus, they provide very powerful systems. So if someone has, like, someone's system is not, you know, that up to the mark, they can use Google Colab. They also provide GPU. Two GPUs, I think, they can access easily from here. Okay.
So is it faster than having this one in our system?
No. Having a system is always better, because the problem with Google Colab is once you log out, your data goes out. Like, they delete your data. Yes, considering the general laptop or desktop configuration, Google Colab, the processor they are giving, it is far more superior.
Because currently I'm using Anaconda, so is it good to use Anaconda, continue with Anaconda, or should I go for Colab?
Yeah, you can work with Anaconda. Now, what about your system? Like Anaconda, you can run in any system.
Yeah.
Your system specification, like how much RAM you have?
RAM, I have, I think, 8 GB RAM.
And processor?
Processor, it is, I forgot the processor.
Okay. So here, Google Colab offers you Xeon processor. Mm-hmm. So Xeon processor, you can do parallel processing.
Okay.
So they have multiple cores. So it is superior than i5, even i7.
Okay.
So if you have some pre-processing job, which you want to like parallelly process, Google Colab is always a better option.
Okay. If you don't mind, one more clarification from you.
Yes.
Because sometimes if I load Excel files, it takes more time to doing it in Anaconda.
You are loading using Pandas?
Yeah, is it after using Pandas?
Okay, what is the size of that file?
It should be somewhere.
Because that depends on your RAM, actually. So your file is big, and if you are using Pandas, what happens with Pandas is Pandas directly copies it. So I will suggest you not to use Pandas if the file is very, you have less RAM.
Okay.
So you can go through different approaches. Okay, so let's begin. Okay, so let me give you a brief introduction of what we are dealing today. So I hope in the morning sir has explained about ECG and how it is generated. Let me reiterate it again. So the ECG signal, the main generation point is from SA node. From SA node, impulse is generated, and it first moves towards the atria. And when it goes to atria, it contracts the atria. And that corresponds to a P wave in ECG. Okay? And then that signal goes downwards through bundle of wrists and Purkinje fibers, and it contracts the ventricles. and that represents the ventricular depolarization and the QRS segment we get because of this. After that, that signal, when it gets repolarized, the ventricle gets relaxed, we get this T wave. So it is one of the widely used modalities for diagnosing cardiac ailments, like early diagnosis of cardiac ailments, because it is readily available and it is also compared to other diagnostic modalities, comparatively cheaper also. But the data which we get from the ECG devices are we cannot readily use because it is contaminated. A lot of noises are there. So as you can see a raw ECG signal in the screen. So here you can see there is a baseline drift. The baseline is not constant. It is gradual, a low frequency noise you can see. Plus there are motion artifacts. The high frequency noise which is available. Plus also the power line interference, it is because of the equipments nearby. So like for Indian scenario, it is 50 Hertz. And if the data is recorded in like from the US or somewhere outside, 60 Hertz. So these noises, these artifacts we have to remove before using it for any purpose. Okay. So first, in today's session, what we will do is we will first denoise this signal. We will take a raw ECG signal, and we will first denoise this signal. After the denoising, we will do beat detection on the ECG signal. So based on that beat detection, we will do beat segmentation. And from that segmented beats of the ECG signal, what we will do is we will extract some features. And we will try to implement some conventional machine learning algorithms using feature-based algorithms. Okay. Following that, after that, we will go into a deep learning-based methods in which we will input our single ECG beat to our network. So everything will be very simplified. We will be using very simple models. Okay. So let's begin. So here, the first cell, we are importing some libraries. So these libraries really help us to do certain tasks like NumPy. NumPy is like a data handling library. Then we have SciPy for doing some basic signal processing stuff. And then we have Matplotlib for plotting the data. Okay. So just everyone, please run this first cell by clicking on this play button. So it will first connect to the server, and after it is connected, then it will run. Okay, so I hope everyone was able to run this first cell. So after this run has been implemented, you will get a tick sign here, a green tick. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, fine. So before moving forward, the data I think I have shared with you, we have to upload the data here. Go to this files option on the right. And then you just upload those three files, the three NPY files, that raw ECG, MI1, and HC1. You upload. Okay, I hope you are able to upload the data. It might take some time depending on the speed of your connection.
Where do you have the files available?
I think one Google Drive link was shared in the chat. I think the first, if you go in the beginning of the chats, you will find one Google Drive link. You just go there and
We are not able to unzip it, sir.
Okay. But this is a RAR file, I think I have shared. Okay, let me share the zip file also. I hope it might work. Okay.
It's giving message that the archive is either unsupported or damaged.
Okay. Let me share this one. I'm sharing a zip file. I think RAR, I think some of you might be having problems. So I'm sharing one with the zip file. You can check now. I have shared the zip file. Those who are unable to extract the RAR file, you can try this zip file I have shared. I hope you will be able to do this.
Yeah, that worked out. Thank you.
Okay, fine. So I hope now everyone has those three files.
I think it's NumPy file.
NumPy file, yeah, NPY file.
Yeah, thank you, it's working.
Yeah, please upload those files in your collab. After you have uploaded those three files, you can run the second cell. This will essentially load the raw file and it will store that ECG file to that ECG variable which we have. You just run that. You can plot that file by running the third cell, so we can see how the raw file looks. Okay. So this is the raw ECG. So as we can see, there is a baseline drift, a bit of sinusoid in nature. Plus, if we can zoom into it, zoom into some samples. Okay, it is quite a nice signal, but still there is baseline drift. I'm not able to see high frequency noise. That's fine, that's very good for us. Okay, so when I write ECG in the bracket 0 to 6000, what it does is it takes first 6000 samples and plots it. The fourth cell I'm referring to. Okay. So, as Sir might have discussed in the session, the clinical components such as the P wave, Q wave, the QRS complex, and T wave, the frequency between like 0.7 to 50 hertz. The QRS complex generally has a range of 8 hertz to 50 hertz. The P wave has a range, I think, 5 to 30 hertz. and T wave varies in 1 to 10 hertz. So any signal other than this component is basically noise. So we have to remove that. So there are many ways to do that. If you go in literature, you will find a lot of methods, a lot of advanced methods, like those who have used transform domains, like wavelet. But for this session, we will stick to basic low-pass filtering and high-pass filtering. So we will implement two filters, three filters actually, one a high-pass filter, one low-pass filter, and one notch filter. So notch filter we are using to remove the power line drift, that is of 50 hertz we have. So we will remove that using a notch filter. So high-pass filter will remove the low frequency noise which we have, like baseline drift, and a low-pass filter will remove all the high frequency noise component. Okay. So these are basically Butterworth filter, and so let's get the parameters ready. So in the next cell, fifth cell, our input signal frequency is of 1000 hertz. So cutoff for high pass we are keeping at 0.6 hertz, and cutoff for low pass we are keeping it 60 hertz, and the power line, let's keep it 50, and the order of the filters are 5. Okay, just run this. Okay. So in the next cell, we have three functions corresponding to three filters. So whenever there is a def return, it basically represents a function. So we have three functions, low pass filter, high pass filter, and a notch filter. So we are using the SciPy signal library. So from it is inbuilt there, the filters are inbuilt there. So we are using from that library, we are importing it from the library, SciPy library. So I will also recommend you to go through the implementation of the filters if you are interested how they have done it. So you can read the documentation of SciPy to get an idea of how these filters are implemented. So as of now, knowing that we are low pass filtering, high pass filtering, and using a notch pass filter is enough for this session. Okay, just run this code, this cell. Okay. I think that we are getting a error. Below the notch filter, replace the I filter with filt. Just copy this and paste it here. And run it. So let's see how the filter has worked. What we get as the output of these filters. Okay. First, let us plot the output from the high pass filter. So high-pass filter will basically remove the low-pass noises. As we can see here in our plot, if we compare with the initial noisy signal, so we are able to remove the baseline drift from the signal. So if we have a closer look, okay, let's see. Okay. Okay, so we get this signal. So baseline wonder, we are able to remove it. Okay. We can also check how it looks after all the filtering, the final, which we have the final after all these three filters. If we just plot the fill three, the third after third filter, this one, if we plot this, let's see what we get. Okay, if we zoom in. Okay, so we can see those ripples in the signals are missing. Those high pass component have been removed. Not high pass, high frequency noises have been removed. So now it looks like a good signal to work on. So the noises have been removed. So after this pre-processing, next step which we will do is we will try to find the peaks. For finding the peaks also, there are many different approaches in literature and very beautiful approaches. So, today we will use a simple but very effective method. If you have, like, if your signal has, like, if you remove the baseline wander and if your R peak is sufficiently good, this method works every time. So, coming to the next cell. So we are storing the filtered file as a data. Just what is this threshold? I will explain in a moment. Time and peak. These are two variables. In time, we will store the information of the time interval where the peak occurs. And in peak, we will store the information of the peaks, the amplitude of the peak. Okay. So in this for loop, what we are doing is we are iterating over 0 to length of data minus 1. So we are iterating over the whole data, this signal which we have. So we are iterating over all the samples of the data. And we are checking some condition. The condition is if this sample is greater then it's like coming sample, like next sample, and if it is greater than the previous sample, if any point which is greater than its previous sample value and also greater than its next sample value, this condition, and we are comparing it with if this is greater than a threshold value. So when these three conditions satisfy, we can assume that it is a peak value. Okay, you are able to get this is the peak value and the corresponding sample we are storing as a time information where this peak occurs. I hope you are getting this, how we are doing this. So we are comparing previous and next sample and then also with a given threshold. This threshold value you can play with it depending on the ECG you have, but 0.8 almost works for every, like mostly works for all the signals which we have encountered. Okay, let's run this file, the 14th cell. Okay. So after that, let's plot whether we are able to detect the peaks or not. Let's see how the peaks are detected. So the next cell, so if you plot this, you can see the peaks are represented by the star, red star. So by this we are able to detect the peaks, the R peaks. A simple method, a simple just if condition, we are able to do this. The same thing you can do in any programming language, even MATLAB also. Like this should work. Okay. In the next step, what we'll do, I hope everyone is following along here. Any issues till now? Okay. Next, we will do the beat segmentation. So we will try to isolate each beats from this complete signal. We will try to remove these beats. So this is also taken from literature. The thing is, if you have a sampling frequency of 1000 hertz, and if you take 400 samples from R peak, like before our peak and 250 samples after our peak, grossly you can segment a single beat. It gives you a total beat length of 650 samples. So this works only if your sample frequency is 1000. So if it is different, you have to correspondingly change these values. Okay. So just run this. So this will do the beat segmentation for us. Okay. So let's plot this. Okay. So here you can see the beats file. So here we have got one single beat. So we are able to extract a single beat. So all our processes, like we will start doing for pre-processing feature engineering, we will do on single beats, whether it is for conventional machine learning algorithm or the deep learning based methods, we will be considering a single beat. And this is how we have extracted it. And the HC1 file and MI file are basically the single beat data of healthy data and one pathological data. HC1 consists of beats around, I think, 400 to 500 beats of healthy data, and MI1 consists pathological data. So we have stored the data, we have done the pre-processing, and we have stored the data as HC1 and MI1. So in the next, what we will do is we will go to feature engineering and conventional machine learning approaches to classify between healthy data and pathological data. So I would request Sibashish to take over from this, and he will explain about the conventional machine learning algorithm. After that, I will again join you to explain the deep learning based methods. Any doubts till now? I hope everyone is able to run and get this data till here. Okay, Sibashish, you can share your screen.
Thank you, Salman. I have shared one notebook, Jupyter notebook file in the chat section. Kindly download that. It is a similar notebook file that Salman has shared previously.
It is denying access.
Yeah. Okay. I'll be sharing again. Is it opening now?
Yes, it's opening.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Okay, so till now, Parvez has covered how to extract single bits from a raw SVG signal. And he covered different signal processing techniques for denoising, followed by bit segmentation. So now I will be covering, suppose we have a set of ECG signals. Some of the ECG signals have been taken from a normal person, and some of the ECG signals have been taken from a person with some heart disease. So in that case, how can we differentiate between a normal ECG and a diseased ECG? So that aspect we will cover in this next 30 minutes. So I'm sharing my screen now. I hope my screen is visible now.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So once this file is open, so I will be covering some basic probabilistic method for classifying the normal ECG and the diseased ECG. Okay. This is a very simple approach. So before I describe what is naive-based classifier, so I just want to so here is that at the moment I have 490 healthy ECG segments and 680 diseased ECG segments. Okay, and what I am doing here is that I am concatenating all these ECG signals into a single matrix, and that matrix is feature underscore x. Okay, and its shape will look like 1170 by 4. I will describe why this 4 comes here, that I will describe later. Okay, and I am giving a label vector is that for healthy ECG the label is 0 and for diseased ECG the label is 1. Okay, so in that way I am simply concatenating these zeros and 1. So the final label vector or the shape will be a single vector of size 1170. Okay. See. So in this particular section, in this particular cell, what I'm trying to do is I'm loading the hc1.npy file, that is the health. That is the ECG signals, ECG bits for a healthy person, and that mi1.npy file, those are the ECG bits for a person having heart disease. Okay, after that I'm simply concatenating all the ECG bits into a single matrix, and after that I'm also concatenating the label vectors into a single vector. Okay. See, now my aim is to classify between a normal ECG and a diseased ECG. So for that, one thing you can observe is that as Parvez has already said, that one ECG bit, the length of one ECG bit is roughly around 650 samples, 650 to 700 samples. So if I consider all the samples for my classification task, then it will be very resource consuming. I mean, it will take a lot of memory and it will take a lot of processing power of my computer. So what I need to do is that instead of using those 650 samples What I will do is I will try to compress that 650 samples into a few number of representative features. Okay, so here my representative features are one is energy, mean of the energy. That means I am simply taking a ECG bit. I'm computing its energy, simply the sample square, and I'm computing the mean. That is one of my feature. Another feature is variance. I'm computing the energy and followed by the computation of variance of the energy. Similarly, two more features are kurtosis and skewness. These are all statistical features, and all these features have been defined in this Python package, that is scipy.stats. You can access the packages, and if you want to know more about these features, you can find them in the Wikipedia pages. They have their own Wikipedia pages. You can find them. So now, finally, my feature length is 4. These four, energy, variance, kurtosis, and skewness, these four are my features for a particular ECG. So similarly, here I have 1170. Okay. Here I have 1170 number of ECG bits. Therefore, my feature vector feature_x will have 1170 number of rows, and number of columns will be 4. So I hope till now everyone following me. If is there any doubt, you can ask. Okay. So this is my data. Right now, this is my data that I will be using for classification. So before I pass it to a classifier, that is the naive best classifier. So what I will do is I will segregate the data into train and test. That a part of the data, here I am giving test size equal to 0.3. That means 30% of my data will be used for testing purpose, and rest 70% of my data will be used for training purpose. Training means here I will be training a Bayesian classifier using the 70% of the data, and that trained model will be tested by the 30% of the data. So these are some standard procedure for normalizing the data, both train and test. Okay, so here this is the basic principle of Bayes theorem. So why do you want to use the Bayes theorem, and what does it say? Bayes theorem simply gives us the posterior probability. That means if I have a particular sample, suppose I have a ECG bit, then it will tell us which particular class, whether it is a normal class or the digital class, what is the probability of the normal class or the digital class. Okay, and for the computation of this probability, it will depend upon this class prior probability and the likelihood probability. Okay, and this particular probability of evidence, which is basically this probability of XM, this is a constant factor, so we do not need to consider it at this moment. This is constant for everyone, for every class. So in this case, I have two classes. One is normal class and this digits class. So here yi will be 0 and 1. 0 for normal class and 1 for digits class. Okay, and this Bayes theorem will give me the posterior probability, that is the probability of class given a particular sample. It will depend upon the class prior probability and the likelihood probability. So now question arises, what is the class prior probability and what are the likelihood probabilities? So in the data that we discussed earlier, we had nearly 480, we had 490 healthy data and 680 digest data. Okay, so out of 1190, there are 490 healthy data. So you can compute the fraction right now, 490 divided by 1190. So that is your class prior probability for the healthy class, and for the digest class, that will be 680 divided by 1190. What is the number? 1170. So 680 divided by 1170. That is the prior probability for my digest class. And the likelihood probability. This particular thing basically captures the distribution of my data. That means this tells us if a particular, suppose I have some idea about a particular class, that is, I have an idea about a healthy class and I also have some knowledge about the digest class, then what will be the distribution of that class? That distribution is this particular thing, likelihood probability. So here we can assume that since we already have the data with us, so we can assume that the data are coming from a Gaussian distribution, or we can simply use our own histogram. We can consider the data and compute our histogram and put it here. Okay, basically the data that we have with us, we are exploiting those data to extract some information about the class, about the healthy class and the digest class. Okay, that is the basic principle behind the Bayes theorem. Then this likelihood probability, in our case we have four dimensional features, so it will be a multidimensional Gaussian. If we consider it as a Gaussian distribution, it will be a multidimensional Gaussian. Okay, now if we consider now we will be considering the naive Bayes case. So what is the naiveness in the Bayesian classifier? So if you look at the equation 2 and equation 3, first come to equation 2. This is basically the equation of a Gaussian. Okay, and Gaussian distribution is defined by the variance, that is the VY here, and the mean value, that is here you can see U. Okay. These two parameters define a Gaussian. And what is naive Gaussian? That means we assume that those four features are independent of each other. That means in the earlier case, here, we consider mean of energy, variance of energy, kurtosis, and skewness. Here, we are assuming that, this is a very strong assumption, is that mean and variance, they are independent of each other. That means variation of a particular feature does not affect the variation of another feature. This is a very strong assumption. So using this assumption, equation 2 can be written as equation 3. That means instead of a multidimensional Gaussian, we are representing that density as a product of single dimensional Gaussians. Okay, and for equation 4, I have written for comparison purpose. If it is a multidimensional Gaussian, the equation would look like this. So here sigma is a matrix and mu is a vector here. But instead, in this case, in this particular P, in this particular density, we have Py, that is the variance, it is a scalar value, and here U also a scalar value. Okay, that is the very large simplification of this, I mean, this particular assumption gives us a very high amount of simplification. Okay. Now the next thing is basically the Python implementation of this particular equation, the naive Bayes equation. Here I have two classes, the normal class and the disease class. That's why. And the Gaussians are defined by mean and variance. That's why I have computed the mean, standard deviation, and the variance. This, all these values will be used in this equation, equation number three, and for classification purpose, we'll be using equation number one. Okay, so now next section, it computes the posterior probability. The posterior probability is computed for the both the classes.
Yes,
this is the posterior probability for class zero, that is the normal class, and the posterior probability for the disease class. Okay, so once the probabilities are computed, these are basically not the probabilities, these are the scores a particular distribution gives. So once these scores are evaluated, what we will do is we will choose the score that has the highest value, and we will assign a test vector, a test ECG sample to that class which has higher conditional probability score. Okay, if you run these codes, so in this cell, I'm basically showing the confusion matrix. So in, you can observe is that on the left side, it is the two labels. That means my test data set, the two labels of my test data set, and this is the predicted level of my test data set. Okay, so here we can observe is that for the normal case, there are nearly 120 number of true identification, but there are false identification is 24. For disease case, there are 92 true identification and 53 false identification. So we can see that this basic assumption of independent feature gives us a moderate performance. But we cannot always assume this this particular condition that the features are independent. Okay, so to tackle that, we will consider another scenario where we will consider the data as a single Gaussian. That means we will consider this formula. We will consider this formula. That means we will consider the whole data, the normal data and the disease data, and compute a multi-dimensional Gaussian scenario. Okay, for that I'm sharing another notebook. Is there any doubt till now? Any doubts?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Is only confusion matrix would be the good measure to identify our evaluations here, or like shall we do some other? What thoughts should be there, or depending on what we should choose the metric?
Yes, confusion matrix is basically the simplest method of representing my system performance. The more better metric will be something like F1 score or unweighted average recalls. I mean, those metrics basically handles the data imbalance case. Here we have mostly the balanced data sets here, but there will be scenario when there will be thousands of normal cases, but hundreds of disease cases. In that case, my matrices should be well enough to handle such kind of scenarios. That's why F1 score is one such metric that will give you that can handle the data imbalance scenario.
And okay. Because in healthcare, mostly we suffer with this problem only that our data is, there is an imbalance in the data.
Yes, yes.
So F1 score would be sufficient measure for that.
You may look at F1 score and combination of precision you can also consider the average of the recall scores. All the recalls you can take and take the average of them. Instead of simply considering the accuracy, accuracy is basically all the true detections divided by the number of samples. Instead of that, we will be using class-wise detections. Class-wise true detection.
Okay.
Are you getting, I think?
Yes.
Okay. In that way, we can do that. Average of the class-wise accuracies. Okay. Now I have shared another Jupyter notebook. You can open it. So that particular notebook, if you open it, you will see something like this. And the title is Illustration of Gaussian Distribution. Okay. And to run this notebook, like earlier case, we need the same data, that is HC1 and MI1. I hope you have already uploaded the data. That means because Parvez has already uploaded the data and you should be able to access those data. If you are not able to access, then you can upload again. Okay, so to tackle the limitation of the Nyquist-based classifier, what we will do is we will consider the relationship between the interdependency between the features. Okay, so for that we will consider this particular expression, this Gaussian expression. Here the sigma is the covariance matrix. And mu is the mean vector. So the dimension of this mu will be 4, and the sigma will be a 4x4 matrix. Okay, so simply this is the implementation of this particular Gaussian function, and I'm not going through the code here. Okay. So here I am trying to show you a simple example by taking some sample random points. I'm trying to give you a simple example here. Here you can see is that suppose my data, I have created my data something like this, and I am trying to put a Gaussian, trying to fit a Gaussian on this data. Okay. So what I will do, if I want to fit a Gaussian on this data, what I will do is I will compute the mean and variance of the data point. And after computing that, I have simply plotted a patch. This blue color patch I have plotted here. This simply indicates the center point mean and the variance of the data. Okay. So here we can see that my Gaussian distribution is very well fitting the data points. Okay. So now let's do the classification thing that we did for the Nyquist class. So here I am again loading the data points. Normal and the digits class. Here I am again computing the features. Again, the train test split I am performing, followed by the feature scaling. Here. So So for the healthy case and for the disease case, we will be fitting a multi-dimensional Gaussian. And the multidimensional Gaussian is defined by a mean vector and a covariance vector. So here I am computing the mean of my data, healthy data, and the covariance of my healthy data. Similarly, for the disease case also, the mean of the disease data and the covariance of the disease data. Okay. So now my Gaussians are trained. Using the trained data, all these parameters are trained. Mean and covariance parameters are trained. Okay. So now I will be using the test data to verify that whether my Gaussians are properly trained or not. So this particular function, normal PDF multivariate, what it will do is it will take a sample ECG bit or the four dimensional feature along with the mean vector and the covariance matrix, and it will return a score. It simply implements this formula that I have given here. It simply implements this formula and returns a score. Okay, so it will return a score. So I am computing scores for all the healthy data and the disease data. Similarly, like the previous case, of naive-based classifier, the test sample which has the higher score, I will be considering that particular class as the true label, as the predicted label. Okay, so between the healthy class and the disease class, which class has the highest value, highest score here, that will be considered as my predicted class. So again I am computing the confusion matrix here, and here you can see that the performance has improved a lot over the naive-based case. But here we also face another problem, and the problem is that if my data points are located something like this. In the earlier case, all my data points were clustered around a single center. But here we have two clusters. For the same class, we have two clusters. You can observe here, there is circular cluster on the left side and a elliptical cluster on the right side. And if I fit a Gaussian over here, you can see that it's not properly fitting it, because its mean is coming around somewhere here. This green point is its mean, and it's not able to properly fit my data points. So what will be the solution next? The next solution will be considered the mixture of Gaussians. Instead of a single multidimensional Gaussian, we will consider mixture of multidimensional Gaussians. Okay. So for that mixture for Gaussians, I'm sharing another Jupyter Notebook file. You can open this code. I hope you are following until now.
Whenever I look at the distribution of the data, so only by plotting I can decide that there is a normal distribution, Gaussian or Poisson, and then accordingly I shall apply.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking, ma'am.
Sorry. If I want to see the distribution of my data, so as you have rightly mentioned here that everything cannot be always a bell curve. So when I want to find out this distribution, what all ways are there that only visualization or plotting the data would be sufficient, that I'll plot the data and find whether it is normal, Gaussian or Poisson, and are there any way, other way?
Here I have given some one-dimensional or two-dimensional data. These are only for representation purpose. When we are working, we normally work with very high dimensional data, maybe 50, 100, 1000, those are the dimensions we work on. So that will not be, if we simply want to visualize the distribution, it will not be possible. So for that, for this particular case, if we want to use this NIBES and Gaussian mixture model, any mixture model, what we will do is we can use our histogram for computing the distribution, or we can fit any other distribution, maybe a Gaussian, maybe a chi-square distribution, or any other distribution, that is any other parametric distribution we have. And we can see how our model performs.
Okay,
that can be one approach.
Can I relate it to the hyperparameter tuning? Maybe very naive question, but I just had this doubt. So can I say that I'm building models and then trying to select one out of it and trying to see what all parameters are affecting and trying to tune it? Can I relate it to that? Or before building the model only I'll have to do all this?
We are trying with the data itself, we are trying to assume. Here everything works on assumption. Whatever till now I have covered, we first assume that the distribution is following a Gaussian, the data is following a Gaussian distribution. That was my first assumption. And for the NIBES case, again, I came for the assumption that my features are independent of each other. And the problem you are saying is that, then how to find the distribution for a particular data set, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so thing is that in a practical scenario, it will not be possible to directly get the distribution. So one approach will be to try different parametric distributions first, and if the parametric distributions are not performing well, another approach will be to use the histogram to compute the distribution.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Oh, and one more thing is that no distribution is not able to fit my data, then we come upon this mixture model, mixture of Gaussians, and in many research work it has been found to perform well, by considering my data, distribution of data, as a mixture of Gaussians. That may also work well.
Okay,
so now I have shared another notebook file here. I'm testing it. You can download this file and open it. So in the last notebook, we assume that our data is the distribution of data is just multidimensional Gaussian. But here, what we will assume is that we assume that my distribution is a sum of Gaussians. Okay. So here, phi I is the mixing component. That means its value varies from 0 to 1. And this f of x given theta, these are multidimensional Gaussians. And here, k is the number of components in a mixture model. Okay, and here mixture means we are simply assuming that sum of a set of Gaussian, set of multidimensional Gaussians. Okay, then how this particular mixture model is trained and how this mixture model can be used for classification that I have given here. So I won't again go into the codes. I will simply cover the concept here. Okay, so if you run this cell, this main program, generate random samples, this particular cell, if you run, what it will give you is this particular plot it will give. So what is this? So let's assume that all these points belong to a particular class, let's say healthy class. Okay, so here you can see that there is one circular cluster, another circular cluster, there is another this is elliptical cluster, another elliptical. So there are five clusters, two circular cluster and three elliptical clusters, all belong to the same class. So by fitting a single Gaussian won't be possible, or even if it fit on the data, it will not justify the properties of my data. So what will we do? We will use a mixture of Gaussians here. Okay, so so here I have assumed that my data has five number of clusters, and I want to train the data. I mean train the mixture of Gaussians. So this is my initial case, that is starting up my training step. So what it does is that all the Gaussians randomly pick samples. Okay, so here you can observe is that the green color is scattered all over the plot. Blue is also scattered all over the plot, because each Gaussian is randomly picking points from all over this figure. Okay, so if you run the next cell, it will try to train the model, and this is just a small animation you can play. And oh sorry, I need to run all other things first. Okay. Now if you run this, it is a small animation, it will show you the training steps, how it converges. See the figure. So initially the clusters were randomly picking points, but as the training progresses, they are kind of confined to their limited spaces. You can observe here is that. Okay, this training algorithm is known as the expectation maximization, and I have already written the code here. You may refer the code. Okay. And if you look at the last step, you can see is that all the clusters are perfectly confined to their limited spaces. So if now we consider as we know that all the points belong to the same class, the healthy class. So instead of fitting a single Gaussian, if we take some of the Gaussians, then this sum of the Gaussians will properly fitting the data points. Okay, so for the next step is the classification task. So for the classification task, what we will do is, so again I am loading the data here. I am performing the scaling, and here I am I'm doing the mixture modeling. Here I am using the Gaussian mixture. It's an inbuilt function present in my sklearn Python package, that is sklearn package. So it's an inbuilt function, you can use it. And here I am using number of components is 3, and random state is the initial, initially the point picking state, which particular points that we'll consider in a particular Gaussian model. Okay, so these two steps are fitting on the data. Okay, so first this particular mixture model underscore H, it fits on the healthy data, and the mixture model underscore D, it fits on the disease data. Okay, so once the model is fit, so we can obtain the score samples. That means we are simply passing the test feature and it will compute the Gaussian values and it will simply sum those values and return the score. Okay, again, we will consider the maximum score. If that digits score is high, then we will consider the digits class as my predicted class. If the healthy score is high, we will consider the healthy class as my predicted class. So in that way, we again computed this. We performed the mixture modeling, and we are plotting the confusion matrix here. So here we can obtain that we can see that the most of the test samples are properly classified. I mean, here we are obtaining almost 100% result. These samples are only for visualization, for representation purpose. So that's why we are getting very good accuracy over here. So till now, any other doubts? So till now, I started with the naive Bayesian case where we considered that features are independent of each other. Followed by, I considered that features are not independent. That's why I considered a single Gaussian to fit the data. After that, I used a mixture of Gaussians to fit on the data, and we see that the performance was progressively increasing as our assumptions were becoming less strict. The performance were improving. Okay, so I have covered the probabilistic different probabilistic models for classification. So, is there any doubt? Now I will invite Parvez to continue with some neural network classification with neural networks.
Thank you, Subhashish. So let me share the Jupyter notebook file with you for this. I have shared the Colab notebook with you. You just try to open it. Okay. So, if you are able to open it, you can see this page. So here we will be training one fully connected network on the data which we had. So just a reminder, we were able to extract the single beats from the raw ECG signal after pre-processing it. And from that single beat, like Subhashish has shown you the conventional machine learning algorithm, how we approach for conventional machine learning algorithms where there is some feature engineering involved. So coming to deep learning, we don't use any specific feature engineering. So this is one of the biggest reason why we use deep learning methods, because we don't have to know the precise features, the precise domain knowledge to make those features. Plus, one more thing, we are not also sure whether those features are able to fully characterize those changes which we want. So those were some shortcomings of like feature engineering based methods, which are slowly being overcome by deep learning methods. Deep learning methods also have some drawbacks, which we will see. So, okay. So just I want to know, have anyone before used any deep learning algorithms before? Like for any task or any network like CNN, LSTM, or a fully connected network? Okay. So generally in Python, we have two major libraries for deep learning. One is TensorFlow, which is by Google, so which was the product of Google Brain. So they have made it available for researchers to use. One is TensorFlow, and another from Facebook, that is PyTorch. The choice of using any library is completely an individual one. I personally prefer PyTorch because I find it like I have more control over the network than what it is available in TensorFlow. But again, you can choose any library you want. So I will be using PyTorch for this session, and I will build one fully connected network using PyTorch. And from the data which we had, which we have shared earlier, HC1 and MI1, the single beats data. So we will input that data and we will see whether that network is able to classify or not. Okay. So as we have seen in that feature-based algorithm, we are able to get good performance based on those features. So let's see whether we can mimic those changes or not. So if not, why? So we will look into it. So first, I'm importing some libraries. So the first two libraries, I think you are aware, NumPy for data handling and Matplotlib for plotting. Then we have some helper functions from the Torch. So Torch, like PyTorch, so we import PyTorch using Torch. So it has some inbuilt functions which we will use directly to build Torch-based models. Okay, so we are importing an optimizer, Atom optimizer. We are importing certain layers, linear, ReLU, cross entropy loss, and sequential. The sequential actually help us to stack different layers and form a full network. And to prepare the data to feed into that network, we need some like data loader functions. So these three will help us to make the data in a format which is suitable for the Torch model to take as an input. Okay, so just let us run this first cell. So let's load the data. So if we run the second cell, we are loading hc1 and mi1.npy. So npload loads the data which are of npy format, NumPy format. So similarly, if we want to save some data, we can save it as np.save, and same data we can load it as np.load. So now we have the healthy data in data H, and the pathological data we have in data M. Okay. Next, we are trying to format the data in a way let me explain this. So full data here, what we are doing is we are concatenating vertically healthy data and MI data. So first we will have a sequence of healthy data, then we will have pathological data. So we are assigning the labels, one corresponding to pathological data, zero corresponding to healthy data. So we are also preparing the label vector Y. So now we are doing train test split. So using a function which is available in scikit-learn library. This is a machine learning library available for Python. So what train test split does is it takes input as a data and labels, and it splits the data on the ratio we provide here, like 0.3%. So like if there are 100 data, 30%, like 30 data will be for testing and 70% data will be for training. So here in train inputs, we get the training data. Validation inputs, we get the testing data, like validation or test, you can say anything. I'm using validation, this nomenclature. Okay, so similarly, we get the train labels and validation labels. So this function splits, make things easier for us. Okay, after we have, let us run this. So after we have split the data, let's do some normalization. So standard normalization we are using, where mean is made zero and the standard deviation is divided by standard deviation. I think it's Z-score normalization, we say it. Okay, so we are normalizing the data. It is really important to normalize the data before we feed it to a neural network. Okay, the next cell which we have here is we are preparing the data for our model, that is PyTorch model, which we will be building in a moment. So if we, let us see what is the type of the data we have. So if we test inputs. Okay, so the data which we have as of now is NumPy array data. So the torch cannot take input as NumPy array. So we have to convert it in a torch format or a tensor format. So first this 4 line, it is converting our data, which was in the form of NumPy array into tensor format. So this 4 are converting in tensor format. We are selecting a batch size as 50. So at a moment, 50 data will be 50 different data set, not data set, different data will be input to the model, which in the literature of machine deep learning we call as iteration. When one batch, the complete the training is completed for one batch, we call it as iteration. And when the complete data has been visited the network, we call it as epochs. So batch size decides the number of data which we send in one go. So here, three helper functions which we are using to create a data set. So sequentially, the data should go to the model. So for that, we need the data loader. From a total of we had around 400 data. So randomly we are selecting 50 data, and that 50 data we have to feed it. And in the next iteration, the next 50 data should come. So that is handled by this function called data loader. And by random sampler, what we are doing is we are randomly taking this 50. Instead of sequentially taking the data, we are randomly taking the data from the data sample. Okay, so if we run this, we have created two data loaders, train data loader and test data loader. So train data loader we will use to train the model, and test we will use for testing. Okay, So for this session, we are making a simple neural network, a simple fully connected network. So here in the next cell, we can see here we have defined a sequential. So sequentially, what it does is it stacks different layers. So if you have an idea of a fully connected network or like deep learning network, you might have seen the structure where the input nodes are connected to a hidden nodes. All the input nodes are like sequentially connected to all the hidden nodes. So the first layer, we have 650. 650 corresponds to the input ECG signal which we had. A single bit we had of 650 samples. So our first layer, it is of 650 samples. Okay, our hidden layer, next layer, it is of 128 neurons. So all those 650 neurons are connected to those 128 neurons. And after that, we are applying a ReLU to apply non-linearity. So this is an activation function which is applied to the output of that layer, like that 128 hidden layer. So whatever we get at an output of that, we are applying this non-linearity. So we are using a ReLU activation function for that. After that, in the next layer, those 128 neurons are mapped to the final two neurons, which will do the final classification. Since we have two classes, we have healthy data and we have a pathological data, so we have two. So for example, if we had 10 classes, if you have worked with some databases like MNIST data, you will have 10 different classes where we identify those numbers. Or if you have IRIS data, those have three final classifications. So based on the final classes, you choose this last input. Okay, and the number of these neurons, these are heuristically determined. You have to like try with different combination to get the optimum values. So there is no any like formula to decide the number of neurons. So you have to like try on at different combinations to get those things. Okay. So let us run this and let us see our model. So this is a basic like a two-layered network I have made, so that like our training will not take much time here. Okay, so we have, so if we print the model, what we have got, we have input 650, output, the output of first layer, and then we have applied ReLU. Okay, and the output, we are applying softmax to give the probability distribution of the final classification. Okay, next, we are defining the training procedure. So for training a neural network, we basically need an optimizer and a loss function. So for loss function, we are using a cross entropy loss. And there are many loss functions, can be experimented. You are free to choose any loss function. But cross entropy has been used in most of the studies. And like depending on your data and what you want, you have to select the loss function. Of course, this loss will work in most of the cases. Next, we are declaring the optimizer. We are using an Adam optimizer. There are other optimizers available, SGD, stochastic gradient descent. And again, it depends on the data you are using and the type of application. So you can try different combinations also and choose the one which suits best for your data. So, and learning rate, we are setting as 0.00.
I love you. Bye.
So learning rate, we are setting. So where I was, okay, learning rate, yeah. Learning rate, we are selecting this. So learning rate, what it does is when there is an update in the weights. So this ratio of like, the weights will be changed at this proportion. So we can change this learning rate. If the learning rate is high, so the model will update, the weight change will be higher. If this learning rate is low, the weight change in previous weight and updated weight will be less. So this is again heuristically you have to determine. Okay, in the next, we will be running for 100 epochs. So epochs means the number of time this this whole data will visit the model. Like our model will see the same data 100 times when training. Okay, fine. So we are iterating over epochs, like 101, 200. And for each epoch, we are loading the data from the train loader, which we have prepared earlier using tensor dataset. So from tensor dataset, we are taking the data and the corresponding labels. So we are changing the data type of the labels to float and long so that the model can handle it. This is a requirement. Optimizer is set to zero grad. Okay, then we are taking the output of the model. So we are feeding the data and we are getting the output. So first, when the model is not trained, we have a raw model and the weights are randomly initialized. So if we input something, we will get some output. It may be anything. So just randomly initialize weight. So based on that output and the corresponding label, we find the loss, the difference, the error function, which we find. So that error function is basically a function of weights of the model. So that weights are back propagated. Like from output, it is back propagated to input using the optimizer function. And that optimizer function basically updates the weight based because it tries to minimize that this loss, this error function. So error function is a function of weights, and optimizer tries to minimize this error function when it is back propagated. Okay, so I would recommend you to go through this back propagation algorithm. It is very beautiful and a lot of resources available. You can go through it to get a better understanding how this loss is calculated, like how it is back propagated. Okay, so this loss dot backward does the back propagation. It sends the loss back to all the in between layers. And this is where the optimizer dot step, when the weights are updated. Once the data has visited all the nodes and we have calculated the loss, and the optimizer weights are updated. And here we are storing the loss so that we can keep track of loss. So our objective is, after every epoch, our loss should reduce and our loss should tend towards zero. This is our final objective. We want to minimize the loss. So we are storing the loss here, just to later, we will try to plot it and see whether how the loss is varying. Okay. So this was the training, full training procedure. Let's run it and see what happens. Okay. Okay. As you can see, it is when it is training, we are also getting the corresponding losses. And as we can see, the losses are the loss is reducing. So if the loss is reducing, it means your model is training correctly. So there will be many cases when you try to run, you will find that the loss is increasing. When such thing happens, what you have to do, you have to change some parameters. Like you might have selected the learning rate higher. That's why the model is not able to converge to a local minima. So all those things, whether your model is learning or not, you can track by tracking the losses. Okay. So the thing which is to be considered to know whether the model is learning is that the loss should reduce after each epochs. Okay. So we have run the model for 100 epochs. Okay. Let's try to print the loss. Let's see. Okay. So as we can see, the loss is reducing. Okay, it is approaching to zero. So it means the model is learning. So our model has been trained correctly. Okay. Now let's test the model on the test loader. So if you remember, we had two data loaders. One was training data loader, one was test data loader. So here what we will do while testing, we will test the data, like we will test the model on the test data loader. So the procedure is same. Everything what we did here for training the model, we will do same here. Testing, we will load the data. But instead of doing this, like sending the log, like calculating the loss and sending to an optimizer, we will try to get the output, what output it is getting. We are not interested in training here. We are just interested in gaining the output, what output it is getting. And that is the final classification here now. Okay, let's run it. Let's see what it is. Like what it is giving. Okay, fine. So as you can see, after running this in the test data, so we had 294 test data. The model accuracy is like really poor, 0.5. And if you compare with the results which was obtained using a machine learning classifier using features, where we get really high performance. So here we are getting very low. So can anyone comment on why it is performing so poorly? The model is correct. Model has been trained correctly. Everything fine, but the result is really poor. Any comment? Just why you think it's fine, whatever you say.
Sir, actually, I think that corrections are not taking places.
Okay, nice.
Feedback, so corrections through feedback. So I think so. So I'm not sure, but I think so that it should be the reason.
Okay.
So every time feedback should be there for necessary corrections.
Yes. Okay, nice. Anyone else? Okay, Kaushik is saying overfitted. Okay, that's also good. Okay, so in the morning, when sir was presenting and when he mentioned that the problems with deep learning, one of the reason was the data. Deep learning model needs a lot of data. If we see here, we have 400, like around 500,000 samples of ECG data, right? And if we see into the parameters of this model, it was a simple network. So if we see our model, okay. So our model input layer was 650, return layer was 128, and output layer was 2. And each of the neurons are connected. So if we calculate the total number of trainable weights, let us see, it is. So if we calculate it, so it is 650.128. So the model has a total of, not five, it is two, like 166,400 trainable parameters. Okay, so this is the total of weights which are trained. And if we look into our data only has 1,000 data sets. So it is very, very, very less compared to the total number of weights we have. And when such thing happens, the model tries to memorize the data, the training data. So it is able to perform so well in the training, if, as we can see in the loss, it is able to perform so well in the training because essentially it memorized every data. As someone has commented, overfitting, yes, this is called as overfitting. When the model, instead of learning the essential features of the underlying data, it memorizes the data. So it has so many, like 160,000, it can easily do that. So one of the thing which we have to consider while training our model is the number of these parameters should be comparative or less than to the number of training sets, like training data which we have, or else there will always be overfitting. Okay. So one of the, I think in the morning, someone also asked, sir, that they are getting state of the art results in some certain tasks, but clinically they are not accepted. This is exactly the reason. So when you train the model on a particular data and you test the model on the same data, you tend to get a good performance. But when the same model is tested on a separate data with separate distribution, the model performs poorly. So essentially what is happening, instead of learning those features which are important to classify this like diagnosis, the model has interestingly learned the data. So one of the challenges of today, like the researchers are working to reduce this thing, how the essential features are learned instead of learning like this type of overfitting, just to prevent overfitting. Okay. Okay, I hope, like, I think this was it. So if you have any question regarding this, you can ask. About deep learning model. And I believe initially, if you are first time seeing this model and everything, it might overwhelm you. It's okay. You just go through it. When you start understanding it, you will get it. The thing is, I have used a simple model, a fully connected network. You can use a CNN network. What happens with CNN, these weights you can reduce substantially because there is a weight sharing concept there in CNN. So ECG classification using CNN is available. You can check online. There are a lot of papers, they have used CNN. So this fully connected network people hardly use for doing any classification because they are not learning any features. They are directly taking the data. So yeah, that's it from my side. If you have any question, you can ask. So we have almost reached the end of this hands-on session. Okay.
Participants, please ask your questions.
Excuse me, sir. Excuse me, sir.
Hello, can you repeat your question? I didn't get, like, there was a misconnection here. Can you repeat the question?
Sir, which type of data gives better accuracy to predict the disease, just like chronic disease? Means type of data means image data or text clinical data. Which gives the better accuracy to predict chronic kidney disease?
That depends on the ability of that data. For example, if I give an example of this heart disease, cardiovascular disease, like in cardiovascular diseases, we say that ECG is one of the readily available modality which can detect these changes on if there is an ailment in the heart. But the problem is if there are like there are multiple ailments which give the same signature in ECG. In such a case, what will happen is there will be misdiagnosis. Because there, for example, if we take two diseases, like if I give you a practical example, myocardial infarction and myocarditis, these are two diseases. And myocardial, the changes which are associated in ECG with myocardial infarction and a patient who has myocarditis, it also gives the same changes. So if a model has been trained to classify between MI versus non-MI, and if a myocarditis patient comes, it will say it is MI. So it depends on the data, whether it is able to, you know, able to extract that feature like of the particular diseases. So that's why we don't use a single data to do classification. ECG standalone cannot be a better diagnosis tool. So we are trying to incorporate different modalities. As you said, image. Yes, an image. For example, if I take image in case of heart, angiography, yes, it gives a different way of different view to the heart and a different approach for diagnosis. So instead of having a single, I would suggest you, if you can incorporate different modalities, you are saying of kidney diseases, if you can incorporate different modalities, because it gives a different view to the same problem, and it can become a more robust to this misclassification type of problem, which occurs with single modalities. And I don't think any modality is perfect. There's also always a shortcoming for a particular modality. So having more modalities is always helpful. That's what clinicians do. They don't rely on a single test. They do multiple tests. They consider different sets of data to do the final classification. So there is no direct answer which modality is better.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Are there any more questions? Okay, if there are no questions, then we may wind up here. So I would like to thank Salman and Sibasis for their session and giving insights to how to process ECG signals and various tools that has been used using Python platform. So on behalf of our team and department, I would like to thank them for their effort and time.
So, thank you, sir. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I hope the participants have learned a lot. And for them who are very much new to this field or new to the Python programming, so it would be slightly more in direction of programming languages, but yet I think everyone have learned something. So thank you, Sivasis and Salman, and thank you all.
Thank you, sir.